Hello folks, welcome back to part two of the Yamaha TDM900 clutch replacement video series. We're at the healing bench with the clutch stack, and as I've mentioned in the video before, we're going to take some measurements. We're going to measure the thickness of the friction plates. We need to measure the warpage of the clutch plates, the free length width of the clutch springs as well, and last but not least, we need to measure the width of the clutch stack as well. But before we jump into any measuring, I've made a little list with the limits I looked up in the service manual. As you can see here, we've got a free length limit of 47.5 millimeters for the clutch springs. For the friction plates, they need to be within 2.9 to 3.1 millimeters. That's in thickness, of course. And the limit is 2.8 millimeters. The clutch plates, we don't need to measure the thickness. And I'll tell you later on why so. All we need to do is measure the warpage of the plates, and it needs to be below 0.1 millimeters. And the clutch stack width has to be between 42.5 and 43.7 millimeters. So we're going to go ahead, take the measurements, and write all the numbers down, and then we're going to have a look at all the numbers and decide what to do next. So let's jump in into measuring. Now, obviously, it goes without saying that if you see any signs of damage or excessive wear, it's a no-brainer to replace, be that the friction plates or the clutch plates. In my case, there are no visible signs of damage. So, in order to measure things, we need to separate the clutch stack. This is the exact way I took them out of the bike. We're not too fussed about the order of the clutch plates apart from one. I'm not sure if you can see that on camera, but this one here is slightly thicker than all the rest. All the clutch plates apart from this one are 2 millimeters, which is the standard thickness. This one here is 2.3 millimeters, which means someone has put a thicker one in to achieve the desired assembly width for the clutch. Now what I need to do is I need to put this clutch plate number one aside, because this needs to be facing towards the clutch cover. All the rest, I don't care about what order they go back in, really. Right, so I'm going to start with the friction plates, because these are the wearing items in focus, you fuck. Yeah, these are the wearing items, the wearing parts in our clutch assembly. And not the clutch plates. So I'm going to take a vernier caliper, and we already established before that the thickness needs to be anything between 2.9 and 3.1 millimeters. So let's go ahead and measure this. So this reads 2.85. So that's very close to the limit. I'm going to write the number down, and I'm gonna carry on and measure all the other ones as well. Now that I've measured all of the friction plates, here are all the numbers. These last ones are the ones that were facing the engine block, and these were all stuck together. And the outer ones, we can see a bit more significant wear. 2.85 is a bit too close to the limit for me. But I've mentioned in the first video, I've got a clutch in order. It still hasn't turned up yet. Delivery must have been delayed or something. So we're going to put a new clutch in anyway. So I'm not too fussed about the friction plates because, as I've said, we've got new ones. So now let's measure the springs. And the way we do that is... free length means when the spring is not compressed, and what we're looking for is 47.5 millimeter. That's our absolute limit. So anything below that is goes in the fuck it bin. And we need to be very gentle not to compress the spring with the vernier caliper. Focus, you fuck. So we've got 48.8 for the first one. Which is good. And I'm gonna carry on and measure the rest as well. Them are 2 millimeters apart from number one, which is 2.25 actually. As I've said, no, I haven't mentioned that, but I'll show you in a minute. We've got a table in the service manual with the different thicknesses for the clutch plates. As you can see, 2 millimeters for clutch plate number one, which is facing towards the clutch cover. The standard is 2 millimeters, and you've got a thinner one and a thicker one. Now in my case, that was 2.3 millimeters. And for clutch plate number two, which is the next one in, you've got only two thicknesses, 2 millimeters and 2.3, and mine is the standard 2 millimeter clutch plate. Now, in order to measure the warpage of the clutch plates, we are gonna need a feeler gauge, and we're gonna pick the 0.1 millimeter one, which is this one. And what we're also gonna need is a surface plate, which I don't have, and not many of us do. I mean, DIY mechanics or whatever. Unless, of course, you're doing this day in, day out, then it is advised to get a well-engineered surface plate, which is usually made out of granite. But what we can use instead, that I'm sure each and every one of us has one in their house, is a mirror, which is perfectly flat. It's part of the mirror's manufacturing process. And what we need to do is lay the clutch plate flat on the mirror, apply some light pressure and just check if we can slide the feeler gauge underneath it all the way around. And I can't, which means there's no significant warpage in the clutch plates. Now I'm gonna go ahead and check the other ones as well. So I've checked all the clutch plates, and each and every one of them is within spec. Now we've made all the measurements, and it's kind of inconclusive because we didn't see excessive wear on the friction plates. All the clutch plates are seemingly good. There are some minor discolorations on the clutch plates. I'm not sure if you can see that. It's the surface isn't rough, and I think it's just the friction material stuck to the clutch plates, because obviously all my clutch was stuck together. Now I'm thinking about whether I should or I shouldn't clean this off with an emery cloth or something, but I don't want to alter the surface of the clutch plates, because this, I'm sure if you can see that, this is a machine surface. It's been surface ground. So I think I'm just gonna leave it alone. Now, this doesn't explain why my clutch has seized, but I've got two theories here. One of which is whether I used the wrong oil. So on my last oil change, I've used a semi-synthetic oil. The other thing that it could be is a phenomenon called ringing of two surfaces. Now, what does that mean? That means two very smooth surfaces, when they are pressed together, they tend to stick together. I don't know. I was hoping to get a definite answer. I didn't. So, as I've said before, I'm gonna slam in a new clutch and use fully synthetic oil this time, and see what happens. Now, before we can conclude the video, there's a few more things we need to check. We need to check the clutch boss and the clutch basket. If I zoom in the camera, you can see these marks. These were made by the clutch plates. It's basically what happens whenever you accelerate or decelerate. The clutch plates hit against one side or the other, see, just like that, and it wears out this this surface here. Now on the clutch boss side, it's the same story. The clutch plates, you know, the metal plates hit against the two sides of the clutch boss, wearing it out. So we need to check for the depth of these marks, if they are prominent and you can see a sharp lip, then it's advised to change either the clutch boss or basket, because that will prevent the clutch plates sliding along here smoothly, and that will affect the engagement of your clutch. There's also a few gouging marks along here, and these were caused by the springs. You can hear that they're fairly deep, but it's nothing to be worried about at this point. And obviously we need to check for cracks and any other size of damage, and if you find any, then I would advise to replace it. Okay folks, that was part two of this video series. I do hope you enjoyed it and maybe you learned something. I'm sure I did. I really enjoyed going through old technical documentation and service manual and all that. I could have just willy-nilly replaced the clutch and get it over with, but I like to understand why things happen, why failures occur, and maybe help prevent it happening in the future. And as I've said, if you enjoyed it, then consider subscribing to my channel, give this video a thumbs up, and make sure you hit the bell icon so you don't miss out on future videos. Take care, and I'll see you in a bit.